My name is Sarah Wales. I'm a Portland girl. I go to Portland Baptist Presbyterian Church. It's between Elmar and Troy. Little Way Church on the Hill is what we call it. I was born and raised there. I was living in Portland except for the exception of a year when we lived in Motherston as newlyweds. I've been married for almost 17 years. My husband is Blair, so I'm trying to get a baseball game, and there's my daughter Mariah. Sorry, I keep saying no. Eleven years ago, I had brain surgery, and I feel that I'm here to tell my story. Each morning when I look in the mirror, I smile inside myself. Not because I'm impressed at what I see looking back at me. I see just an ordinary woman. I smile because I'm reminded of what God has done for me. As I run my brush through my tangled hair, a scar appears. The left side of my brain has a scar in the shape of a question mark. It is a reminder of the time in my life when my faith was weak and I was beyond vulnerable to fear. It is a daily reminder of where God has brought me to. A reminder to leave things in God's hands and not try to do them all on my own. It was fall of 2005. Each time I looked at the calendar, my heart sunk. The day stuck out like the unblinking light. November 7th, my scheduled date for brain surgery. I looked at it over and over, as if something would change, as if I would be given more time. When I was 7 months old, I spent meningitis. It was scarring on my brain. 8 years later, I had my procedure due to the scarring. I would have those seizures for almost 20 years. My parents have taught me, ever since I was small, there are always other people out there who are worse off than you. And I always believed it. If you sit and dwell on your problems, life will pass you by. Instead, look around, and you see how blessed you truly are. Unfortunately, that fall, I could not see all my blessings. I was in a mad rush to get everything in my life organized. I had so much to do. My husband's jeans needed to be mended. The same jeans that sat in the mending pile all summer long, all spring before that, probably really back into the winter time. But they had to be mended. They sat all summer collecting dust. But now I shook the dust off, and now I mended them. Just in case. It was as if I'd forgotten Matt knew how to get to the store and buy himself a new pair of pants. Jacob's baby book needed to be updated. The family pictures weren't yet hung on the wall. Something for my son to remember me by, just in case. So much needed to be done, and time was running out for me. Was I crazy? Why hadn't I picked the beginning of December or waited until after Christmas? Dr. McNerney had let me pick the date. I could have chosen any time for surgery, as long as it was on a Tuesday or a Thursday. And here I was, with less than 2 weeks to go. Fear crept in and overtook me. I try to keep my faith strong, but every day I fear that I may not come back to my family. I fear I may be kissing Matthew for those last times. I fear I may be reading to Jacob for those last days. I was obviously trying to fit in more hours than I had. We can't add more time. Our cards are already dealt to us. I recall those conversations with God were weak, I was weak. I lost the hope that faith brings. Am I doing the right thing, God? I asked. Of course I am. I answered myself. I reminded myself of all the testing that had gone so smoothly, the Hoshi Medical Center, the EEG, the MRI, the WADA test, the CAT scan. Kennedy's test worked in my favor. I reminded myself of the visit with the surgeon, the feeling of assurance he gave me when we discussed the operation. He described clearly what surgery would entail. We're going to cut into the left temporal lobe, he said, and we're going to take out the scar tissue. I had confidence in him, so why now did I feel this way? God wouldn't bring me this far and suddenly turn me around, would he? We had a rack in our driveway. It was a nice big clunker of a rack at the end of the driveway that I had planted flowers around. And my husband decided to widen the driveway. So we moved the rack. Or wanted to move it. I'm like, no, just wait. Wait till I can get my flowers moved. Well, I didn't get the flowers moved. And winter came in the snow. So, the rock got covered, and a lot of people ran into that rock, and they backed out of our driveway. But that rock didn't move. And I wish I could have faith like that. But unfortunately, I'm not that strong. You know, it's just, we're all made like that. Our faith at times will just waver, but I wish I could be as solid as that rock. And my husband finally had it, but this rock is gone. But I think of that rock when I think of faith. Brain surgery is what I wanted more than anything. But there was something that was fighting within me, and I couldn't understand. I kept telling myself it was just nerves. It's not like every day you want to have brain surgery. Yeah, the closer the day came, the more irritable I became. One minute, I'd be snapping my husband's head off, and the next minute, I'd be crying. Life was a roller coaster in our house, and you better hope you were hanging on for the ride. At one point in time, my husband thought he might have to have surgery before me to have his head sewed back on from being chewed off. I wondered if we would have another Thanksgiving together. Would we celebrate our next anniversary? Would I ever see those familiar faces again? What if I didn't make it through surgery? Who would rock my baby boy goodnight and sing kumbaya to him if I never came home? Who would care for him while my husband was at work? Who would love my two guys like me? Every day, my brain spun in a thousand different directions. My husband walked around on eggshells, and I walked around wondering if I would make it through. Instead of believing, I questioned and doubted. Matthew 6:27 says, who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? Once again, I stood at the kitchen sink with my hands immersed in soap suds, a place where I often talk to God. As I washed the dishes, I looked out the window where the heavens reached down and touched the countryside. For the 100th time, I asked God if I was doing the right thing. Ring, ring, what the telephone? And I remember so clearly, I remember answering that, and I remember hearing him say, you might want to talk to her. was my sister-in-law. And she informed me that my surgery date had been changed. And I listened to her words in disbelief. I wondered how she knew my information, my hospital information. And I was clueless. No, it hasn't, I answered sharply. I just spoke from the hospital a couple days ago. Everything is set.
Yeah.
Besides, I was a patient. Why would they be giving her my information?
Yeah.
I thought of the arrangements that I had made for someone to care for her son, someone to take care of her animals, and all the hotel reservations for family that had already been made. I'm just telling you what they told me, she's the answer. They said it's been changed to the 28th, so you might want to call them. She was probably wishing she hadn't even called and told me. She was getting the kind of communication from me that my husband had been getting for the past month. I called the hospital and found out that my surgery had indeed been rescheduled from the 7th to the 28th. I obviously failed to ask the most important one, the one who watches over me like no other. And I remember when I was talking to Hershey, I got really short with the person I was talking to because they told my sister-in-law my information. I remember my husband going, "Honey, you might want to be careful. They're going to be slicing your head open in a couple weeks." So I had to calm down, and then I called my mom and I cried, and my mom was like, "Oh, honey, it's okay. Everything is meant for a reason." But after that, I was okay. The surgeon had let me pick the date. Yeah, I had not checked with my heavenly physician. He'd been trying to contact me the whole time. Not on the telephone or through an email. Right in front of me, and I was not paying attention. I was too wrapped up in worry and fear to hear his voice. Picking the date of my surgery was granted by my surgeon, but I never prayed and asked the great physician for his input. I wasn't listening to his call. You can't ask God for help and not give him the reins. And I looked back on that fall, and I was constantly asking God. I remember looking out the kitchen window by the sink and asking God, "Am I doing the right thing, God?" Because all through the year, I started the touching in January, and all through the year, everything went smooth. But all of a sudden, something just did not jive. Something wasn't feeling right. And I look back now, and that feeling was in the pit of my stomach. And when I used to have seizures, I used to have a warning in the pit of my stomach. And it's unexplainable. The doctors would always ask, "Well, what kind of feeling is it?" "I don't know. It's just a weird feeling in the pit of my stomach," is all I could explain. And it wasn't the same seizure warning feeling, but it was a feeling in the pit of my stomach from God. It was a heavy feeling, but I ignored it. I just pressed on because I was looking at the what if. What if? What if? And I had to have all my ducks in a row. I had to have the wheel done, the baby book, the pants, the house had to be clean from head to toe. Why? I don't know. And prior to this, before we got married in 2000, my surgery was in 2005. But prior to this, when we were engaged, I wanted to have surgery before we got married. And I asked my Christian Medical Center and tried the testing. And all the testing went fine except one. I had to do the EEG monitoring, which I was in the hospital for 12 days each, with all your EEGs on your electrodes on your brain, and you're being monitored on a TV, you're being recorded. And you can only go, the bathroom was really privacy. That was like my leash. I had to go forward as a leash. And I was in there for 12 days and I didn't have a single seizure. So it didn't do any good because they couldn't record the brain waves or where the seizures were coming from. Okay, we'll try it again because all the other testing they had tried it again. Same thing. But as soon as I got home each time, I had seizures. Tried it for the third time. Got home on Christmas Eve. Had seizures. And after that third time, I told the doctor, I said, no, I said, I don't want it. He asked me, he said, you can do it again. I said, no. I said, someone's telling me, it's just not time. So here we are. You go on with life, you get married, have kids, buy a house, well, have a kid, buy a house, you know, you go on with life. And then here we are, we tried it again. All the testing went smooth. And then here we are in the fall, and something's just not right. So I'm just like, okay, it's just fear. I'm just scared. And then I got a phone call. Fear got me nowhere, other than the fact that it took away a lot of my joy and happiness that fall. Fear can cause us to miss the voice of God. Isaiah 41:10 says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. We hear it unmistakably again in Isaiah 41:13. For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says, do not fear, I will help you. November 28, 2005, I walked into the doors of Hershey Medical Center with my husband by my side and surrounded by family. The rest of our family and church community were back home sending out prayers to God, who was listening and answering. That was last fall, which was 11 years ago. Since then, I asked my sister-in-law why she called the hospital. Stacy doesn't remember. She has no recollection of even talking to them. Her answer to me, she replies, are you sure it was me? Followed by, maybe you were dreaming. I wasn't dreaming. I remember so clearly. Maybe it was a one-sided conversation, but I know for a fact it happened. It was not a dream. Today I see the shady leaves differently, the flowers differently, even my family differently. When something like that happens, I believe without a doubt that it is God reminding us of who is in control. It is easy to let fear overcome us. Fear often sneaks through an open door, or open window of our souls. Sometimes it sneaks in without us even realizing. If we are not careful, it finds a permanent residence inside of us. Fear can easily overrun our lives, leaving us weak and vulnerable, almost defenseless, robbing us of our faith. Faith grows as we put our eyes not on what we are facing, but on the God who is stronger than anything we can face. I ask you this, which do you have more of, fear or faith? Thank you for having me tonight. God bless you all.